The Lord be with you. Welcome to our online service for Palm Sunday. It's a great delight that some of us are able to be back in the building, but we know that that's right for some people and not for everybody at this point, so we're really glad that we're still able to have an online service as well. Today we remember Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and we mark the beginning of Holy Week. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, during Lent, we have been preparing by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today, we come together to begin this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that united with him in his sufferings, we may share his risen life. Let us pray. True and humble King, hailed by the crowd as Messiah, grant us the faith to know you and love you, that we may be found beside you on the way of the cross, which is the path of glory. Amen. We're going to hear our Bible reading read for us today by Maggie. And after that, Miles, who is here with us on placement, is going to preach for us.
Mark 11, 1-11. Jesus comes to Jerusalem as king. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Here ends the lesson.
God grant that in the written word and in the spoken word, we may behold the living word, our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. This morning we come again to the glorious day when we recall Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. This day marks the beginning of the Passion narrative and the beginning of Holy Week. This coming week, we will be on a roller coaster of emotion, starting from this glorious and triumphant arrival of Christ into Jerusalem. We then approach a more sombre period in which we see the Last Supper, Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, and then we move to tragedy and sorrow, in which we see Jesus's betrayal, arrest, and crucifixion. Then, just at that moment, when it looks like all things are lost, suddenly the tomb is empty, Christ is risen, and death itself has been overcome. Palm Sunday is a day of rejoicing. It's a day which we should celebrate, and we see this in our gospel this reading this morning. As Jesus arrives into Jerusalem, the crowds are ecstatic with joy. They throw cloaks, reeds, and palms on the ground in front of him, and shout praise to him. To them, this is the moment the Messiah has finally come. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, however, would have been a strange image for them. The Jews had foretold of the coming of the Messiah, imagining it to be like the coming of a war leader who will come to the aid of Israel and reclaim their land from the Romans. Instead of this, something quite different happens. The Messiah enters Jerusalem, but he does so humbly, on a donkey. It's safe to say this is not what they would have expected. Jesus was never one for behaving how people expected. What's interesting about the entry into Jerusalem is that it is slightly out of character for Jesus. Until now, he's never been one for acclaim, and certainly not on this scale. So this begs the question, what was Jesus trying to say by this entry into Jerusalem? It's safe to say that by this point, Jesus' fate is sealed. While the disciples still don't understand or have much of an idea about what's coming next, Jesus knows perfectly well he is going to meet a violent death, and his entry into Jerusalem would be his last. He will never leave here again. Bearing this in mind, it makes sense as to why Jesus would enter Jerusalem in this manner. Jerusalem is effectively a stronghold of those who wish to do him harm. It is the hub for the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Roman capital of the province. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, therefore, is a clear statement and a direct challenge to his opponents. But it is a peaceful one. At this point in history, donkeys are seen as peaceful animals. And even now this is true, it's difficult to imagine an unpeaceful eel. But at this time, princes and political or military leaders would ride a donkey into a city instead of a horse if they wanted to signal peaceful intentions. So even though Jesus' entry into Jerusalem was clearly in peace, and that couldn't be questioned, it was still an incredibly powerful challenge. Indeed, this is one of Jesus' most provocative acts so far, as it is a direct challenge to those in political and religious leadership in Jerusalem. Jesus, in a way, is mocking them. He enters Jerusalem in a similar manner to that of a military procession, or the entrance of a king, or a triumphant national hero. And he's getting a huge reaction from the crowds, and being greeted as only a king would be. It's important also to remember Jerusalem's place as a royal city. Jerusalem is the city which King David made the capital of his kingdom, and his son King Solomon built the first temple. This city is the heart of royalty and kingship. So when Jesus enters the city in this manner, and is greeted by crowds shouting, "Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David," you can see how this would have infuriated those in leadership, and Jesus would have known this. You can see also how after this entry, many in the crowd would have seen this triumphant entry as a step closer to Jesus, the Messiah, establishing a throne in the city and reclaiming Israel from the Romans. All of this actually fits very well with Jesus' entire ministry throughout the last 3 years. Jesus has consistently turned power, social norms, and current understanding on their heads, and you can see this throughout the Gospels. Jesus' statements, such as "the first shall be last and the last shall be first," his commenting, "it's harder for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven," or his dining with tax collectors, his associating with sinners, lepers, and all those cast out from society. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem is in many ways a large-scale dramatic representation of Jesus' entire ministry. Jesus has come to shake up society, to shake up, and indeed to change the world and everything and everyone in it. He has come to bring the kingdom of God to us and to form a new covenant with his people. So for the people in Jerusalem witnessing this entry, for the disciples and all those who have followed Jesus, this is a pivotal moment for them. And it is just as important for us today as it was for them 2,000 years ago. Palm Sunday signals the coming of the Messiah. It signals the beginning of the greatest and holiest week there has ever been. Throughout this week, there will be rejoicing and celebration. There will be pain and sadness. There will be desperation, and there will be hope. And this week will end with the greatest miracle there has ever been. So as we go through this week, especially after the last year we've had, let us approach this week as ourselves, lifting up to God all the things which have happened in the last year, bringing our rejoicing, laughter, and hope, but also bringing our sadness, our grievances, our pain, and our difficulties before God. the events that will take place in the coming days. Show us God's all-encompassing and everlasting love for us all. So let us bring ourselves with everything and everyone we hold close on the journey we take this week, holding all of these things before our ever-loving God. Amen.
Our hymn today is Ride On in Majesty, sung for us by our own church choir. And after that, Clive will lead our prayers for us.
Let us pray to the Father, through Christ who gave himself for the life of the world. For forgiveness for the many times we have denied Jesus, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the grace to seek out those habits of sin which mean spiritual death, and by prayer and self-discipline to overcome them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Christians everywhere that despite the suffering of disunity, they may grow a rich union in Christ. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who make, interpret, and administer the law, that our common life may be ordered in justice and mercy, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who still make Jerusalem a battleground, and all who live in the shadow of conflict, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in the darkness and agony of isolation, that they may find support and encouragement, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who are weighed down with hardship, failure, or sorrow, feel that God is far from them. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those who are tempted to give up the way of the cross, and those who do not know the hope of God in Christ Jesus, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. That we, with those who have died in faith, may find mercy in the day of Christ, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Holy God, holy and strong, holy and immortal, have mercy on us. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
As I've said, today is the beginning of Holy Week. There are going to be Zoom Compline services on Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday evening. The link to join in with them on Zoom is in the weekly update, or do contact the church office if you would like to have it sent to you. On Thursday, there'll be an online service as we mark Maundy Thursday and remember Jesus at the Last Supper with his friends. And on Good Friday, the church is open for personal prayer between 12 o'clock and 3 o'clock. Also on Good Friday, there's going to be a Zoom all-age service at 10 o'clock. That would be really suitable for children and families. We'd love you to join in with us. And again, the link will be in the weekly update and also available in the Children and Families Facebook group. When we get to Easter Day, we're glad that, again, we're going to be able to have services in church. You do need to book for those services if you would like to come to one of them. There's still plenty of space for our 8 o'clock service of communion, which is going to be outside, and our 4 o'clock Church at 4 Easter service, which is also going to be outside, so you'll need to bring a picnic blanket to church at 4, or for the 8 o'clock service, a camping chair if you want to sit down, or come prepared to stand for about 30 minutes. There is still some space at 10 o'clock, but it's filling up, so really important that you book if you want to be at any of our Easter services. And you do that just by emailing Mary or phoning the church office. We do hope that whatever the coming week looks like for you, it is a holy one and a one where you know God walking with you through these events as we remember again all that we think of in Holy Week and then prepare for our celebrations next Sunday. Christ crucified, draw you to himself. To find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.